Hello students, how are you all? I hope you are doing fine at home. I am your teacher Tree Neha, and today we are going to see the chemistry of class 9th standard, and the name is Lees. Water. So children, in previous class we have discussed about the occurrence of water, composition of water, and we have also seen how the relative study between the metals and non-metals was done. Then we also studied what is the chemical property of water and physical property of water. So students, today we are going to see an interesting topic, and the topic is water of crystallization. So before going into this, we should know that what does this mean. For that, here I have an example. So children, here you can see that here there is a blue salt and this side there is a white color salt, right? So this blue salt and this one is both copper sulfate. What are these? CuSO4. Okay? So the main difference between these two salts are, one is having water molecules and another is not having any water molecule. So children, this substance which is white in color is known as anhydrous copper sulfate. Anhydrous means there is no water molecules present there. Same way, this blue color substance is known as copper sulfate pentahydrate. Pentahydrate means 5 molecule of water is present inside that. Okay, so this is known as the hydrated form, and this one is known as the anhydrous form. Same way, let's go to the one more example. So I am taking here one salt, and the name of the salt is cobalt chloride. Okay, so this is cobalt chloride, and you can see that both the colors are different, right? So the first one is blue in color and the salt name is anhydrous copper, or here it's anhydrous cobalt chloride. Same way, if you add little water molecules to that, it will become pinkish in color, and the name of this is also cobalt chloride with 2 molecules of H2O. Okay, so this way you can see that in this there are 5 molecules of water, and that side there are 2 molecules of water. So water of crystallization means the fixed number of water molecules attached with a substance or a salt. So what is water of crystallization? The fixed number of water molecule. Okay, so that's what is known as water of crystallization. So children, now let's see what does the other example of water of crystallization shows. So children, there are various examples for water of crystallization. So the first example which we are taking here is, we are taking copper sulfate. So copper sulfate, I have already told that it contains 5 molecules of water molecule, and it will be blue in color. So the formula of copper sulfate is CuSO4, and there are 5 molecules of water, so you can write it as 5H2O, and the color is blue. Same way, the second example is iron sulfate. Iron means Fe and sulfate means SO4. So iron sulfate is having 7 molecules of water. So FeSO4 plus 7H2O, and the color will become green in color. And without this water molecules, the color of iron sulfate will be little bit brownish in color. Same way, sodium carbonate, magnesium sulfate and zinc sulfate are having white color substances, but there is one difference, that in these substances there is some kind of moisture present, that is fixed number of water molecule. So in sodium carbonate there are 10 molecules of water, so you can write it as sodium carbonate is Na2CO3 with 10 molecules of H2O. Same way, Magnesium sulfate will have 7 molecules of water. So it is MgSO4 with 7 molecules of H2O. And the last one is zinc sulfate. And in zinc sulfate, there are again 7 molecules of water. So you can write it as ZnSO4 plus 7H2O. And you can see that all these elements are having white in color. So you cannot just verify, or you can see that whether the water molecules are present or not. But in the above, you can see that water molecules are present, because due to the adding of water, the color changes. Okay, children? So this is there in the textbook as well. So children, let's see an experiment. So in this experiment, we are going to see whether water molecules are really present in hydrated form of copper sulfate. So what we are doing is, we are taking hydrated copper sulfate, in that we are putting that inside a test tube. Now we are putting that copper sulfate in the test tube. What we are doing is, we start heating it. So when we are heating it, you will see that the blue color which is there for the copper sulfate hydrated, it will change into white color. So when it is changing into white color, it is visible that some kind of water molecules have been evaporated in the form of steam. And later on, you are keeping the anhydrous copper sulfate here. Now again, you want to test that if you add water, will the white color change into blue color? So what you are doing is, you are taking water and you are adding into the test tube. And finally, what you see is, there is blue color substance, and here you can see that the blue color is having copper sulfate plus H2O. And same way, white substance is only copper sulfate which is in anhydrous form. So this way we can do the confirmation. Okay, so now let's come to the types of salts. So children, types of salt, first salt is known as hydrated salt. So hydrated salt, the best example which I can give you is copper sulfate with pentahydrate. Penta means 5 water molecules. Same way, anhydrous substance means when the water molecules can be removed, that is, water of crystallization can be removed. And the example is anhydrous copper sulfate. Then diliquescent substances. So children, diliquescent means when you are taking a substance and you are keeping in the atmosphere. So when you are keeping it in the atmosphere, you will see that that solid, it will absorb the moisture from the surrounding and it will change into a liquid or a slimy form. And the best example is sodium. So when here you are taking sodium chloride and you keep it outside, these are the pellets or these are the salt balls, okay? When you are keeping it out, you will see that it's losing the solid property and it is becoming liquid. Now let's come to the hygroscopic substance. So one difference is there. Here, if you are keeping the substance outside, in diliquescent, it will absorb and it will become liquid. But in hygroscopic, what will happen is, it will absorb the moisture from the surrounding, but it will not convert it to a liquid. It will remain as it is. And the best example is here, sodium chloride. And here, the example which you have taken, sodium chloride, which is not in a pure form, okay? So don't get confused. Even sodium carbonate we can take here. And then come the efflorescent substances. So efflorescent substances means when there is a substance, and after adding more substance, what will happen? There will be a point when the solution is not getting mixed. What will happen then is, when it starts getting cool, it will become a crystal form. So that substance is known as efflorescent substance. Okay children? So now let's come to the topic, which is water. So since we have started this lesson children, we are talking only about water. So now let's see what are the main 2 different types of water. So what you can see in the figure children? Here you can see that one water is a little blackish in color and another one is clear solution. So how does this come? So there is 2 different types of water. One water is known as soft water and another one is known as hard water. So what is the main difference between these water is, in soft water there will be no Ca2 plus and Mg2 plus. That is, these two ions will not be present and it is good for drinking. Same way, if you are talking about hard water, in hard water there will be presence of calcium and magnesium ions. Later on, this hard water can be divided into two ways. And what are the two substances is? See here children, the two substances which are here and the two things which we are going to discuss here is a temporary hard water and permanent hard water. So the first one is temporary and another one is permanent. So children, about temporary and permanent hard water, we are going to see details in this lesson. So how to do in this chapter is, first we have to see that why temporary hardness of water came. So I told you the hardness of water will generally come due to the presence of calcium and magnesium. But here what happens here is, there are two types of water. One is temporary hard and another one is permanent hard. So when you are calculating about the ppm, that is part per million, in that particular place you will see that in the soft water there are zero particles or zero presence of calcium and magnesium, but as you come to the hard water there will be high amount of minerals present in that which are harmful for us. Okay, so let's see what are the main causes. So the main causes, I have told that it is due to the presence of calcium, bicarbonate and magnesium bicarbonate. So these are the two substances due to which you can see that there is temporary hardness in the water. So now let's see how this temporary hardness comes. So the temporary hardness comes when it's raining. So you must be thinking why you are saying that it's raining, right? So listen to me here children. What happens here is, when it's raining the water is pure. So but what happens is, when it is coming down, gases which are there in the atmosphere, for example carbon dioxide gas, will add with the water molecules and then it will become a gaseous water with carbon dioxide, and that water touches the stone and the stones are having calcium carbonate. When these are getting added, you will see that a calcium bicarbonate is being generated. It can be due to the presence of calcium salt or it can be due to the presence of magnesium salt. Okay, so it depends upon the mineral on which the rainwater is falling. Okay, so now let's see how you can remove the temporary hardness of the water. So temporary hard means there are bicarbonates present. So when there are bicarbonates present, what you can do is, you can take your substance which is calcium bicarbonate plus you are heating it, and when you are heating it, what you will get is, you will get calcium carbonate plus H2O will go as steam. Okay, same way calcium bicarbonate can be replaced with magnesium bicarbonate, and when you are heating it, it will go as magnesium carbonate plus the steam. So this is the way how you can remove the temporary hardness of the water. Okay, same way, what are the causes of permanent hard water? So permanent hard water is due to the presence of calcium and magnesium, but to addition to that, there is calcium chloride. After calcium chloride there is magnesium chloride, and not only chlorides but even sulfates are present. So there will be calcium sulfate and potassium sulfate. So these are the main causes why the permanent hardness of a water appears. Okay, children? Yes. So now let's see how you can remove the permanent hardness of a water. What you have to do is you have to take your hard water. So in this hard water there is calcium chloride or magnesium chloride, calcium sulfate or magnesium sulfate. Now what you are doing is you are adding to it sodium carbonate. So let me write the equation. Like, you can write MgSO4, which is magnesium sulfate, when you are adding sodium carbonate, that is Na2CO3, what will happen here is double displacement will take place. So this sodium will connect with the salt of sulfate and magnesium will go and connect with CO3, and the answer will come as MgCO3 plus the remaining is Na2SO4, or here you can just remove the 2, it will become sodium sulfate and magnesium carbonate. So magnesium carbonate is what, children? Here magnesium carbonate, if you are heating it, it will just get removed with the vapor. Okay, so this way you can add calcium sulfate, calcium chloride and even magnesium chloride. Okay, now let's come, what are the disadvantages of hard water? So disadvantage of what hard water is, you cannot use it for drinking. It is unfit. You should never drink hard water because due to the presence of different chemicals, it can affect your body. Same way, you can not use the hard water for cleaning off clothes. Okay? And then you cannot take bath because if you are taking bath, you want to clean yourself, right? So if you are using hard water, you are not just cleaning yourself, but the skin will also get damaged. Okay, so no taking bath. Then therefore we cannot use it for cleaning, because in dye industry, if you are using dye product, with that if you are using the hard water, it will remove, it will fade off the color. So in dye also you cannot use it. And the last one comes to the boilers. So children, boilers are a big instrument, as you can see here in the figure. What happens here is it's boiling the water so that it is affordable, or you can just drink that water. So what happens here is, if you're taking hard water and you're just using the boiler, there will be some kind of salt which will be surrounding this particular instrument, and it can spoil the boiler. Okay, so this is why we should not use hard water. So students, I hope you have understood what are all things we have discussed here. So today in this video session we have discussed about the hard water, and the hard water we have discussed this temporary hard water and permanent hard water, and how you can use these substances for another substances, or plus how you can remove the hardness of the water. So children, later on we have seen that why we should not use hard water, right? So students, I hope you have enjoyed the session. Until we meet next time again with the next and super video. Until then, bye bye.